Good afternoon. My name is Giuseppe Nesi. I am the Dean of the Law School here in Trento. And first of all, I'd like to welcome all the participants in this workshop and of course, the speakers. And I'd like to thank them very much. I will spend just a few words to introduce this workshop and then to explain something about the format we are going to follow, which has been agreed by all the speakers today. So I'd like to explain, first of all, why we, Marco Pertile and myself and the colleagues who are here around, organized this workshop entitled Conflict, Indigenous Peoples and Natural Resources, New International Law Perspective. Firstly, I would say that the reason is, so to say, a utilitarian reason, a functional reason. We wanted to take advantage of the presence in Trento of three true specialists the issues we are going to discuss. You may know that, especially Elisa Morgera, but also the others, I think, were advising one of our new PhD, Federica Cittadino, who is here today, who discussed this morning her, who presented and defended today in the morning her thesis on indigenous rights and the protection of biodiversity, a study of conflict and reconciliation in international law. So we had to take advantage of the presence of Daniëlla, Mauro, and Elisa here in Trento, and I think that we are going to take full advantage of their presence. You will see what we are going to do today. As it emerged from our guest CVs, and for the reasons that I will better explain later, Elisa, Daniëlla, and Mauro have been working in recent years on the wide range of issues we are going to discuss. And their work has produced, in my opinion, quite tangible results, such as the books and essays that will be presented this afternoon. Their research activities and those books and essays have contributed to the development of some theoretical and practical aspects of the issues we will touch upon today. I refer mainly to the issues of the relationship between indigenous peoples, natural resources, and conflicts. When you talk about those issues, you deal with major economic, human rights, and political themes that cannot be ignored if you want to understand and explain to others what happens when, for instance, different and divergent claims on natural resources are presented by different actors. The second reason why we wanted to organize this meeting is that our law school, and especially some of the international lawyers, but also others, I must say, and I thank Roberto Tognatti, our former dean, who is here, and I welcome him. Many of us here in Trento have devoted a lot of attention to issues linked to conflict, national resources, and human rights. And I think that the comprehensive studies, competences, and experience accumulated in these fields by our colleagues here in Trento have been one of the factors that led the University of Trento, within its School of International Studies, to set up a master in international security. In this master's framework, conflict, natural resources, human rights, and their interconnection will be studied in depth, because unfortunately the issues of security, and of course I refer also to terrorism, I refer to the protection of data, I refer to many issues linked to the use of the web, require a lot of attention by us. So with the permission of our rector and the director of the School of International Studies, I would say that today we are also here to launch this new important teaching and research initiative. Finally, contrary to what happens with many university professors, we have a very practical approach to research. We want to believe that, especially in international relations, any problem has a possible solution. However, you cannot provide any solution if you don't know very well what the problems are, what are their roots, what are the interests involved. I understand that 2 hours and a half are not sufficient to fully examine the complex issues at stake today. However, I am quite confident that by 5:30 p.m. today, we will know much more, and maybe we will also we could also indicate some possible solutions to what we're going to discuss, as it has been the case for the books and papers we will focus on during this afternoon. Now, I would explain in a few words what the format of this afternoon's meeting will be. We will have three sessions. In the first session, Daniëlla and Marco will discuss on the issue of governance of natural resources in conflict and post-conflict situations, the case of indigenous peoples. And our idea, which has been agreed, as I told you before, is that the discussant, so we are going to follow a different approach than usual. The discussant will make a short introduction of the work, in this case of the book, written by Daniëlla. Then there will be a discussion, a lively discussion, we hope, between the author and the discussant. So it will be about 20, 25 minutes. Then there will be a short session of questions and answer, 5 to 10 minutes, and then the other author and discussants will come here, and we will follow the same scheme until the third, and then we will have a final session altogether. Okay? So, I think that I accomplished in a quite clear manner the tasks assigned to me by Marco, so I did my homework, and I give you the floor.
Thank you very much, Professor Nesi. Thank you very much, Dean. And thank you, Daniëlla, for being here. So allow me, I'll be very short on this introduction, because I want to interact and have...
I'm sorry, Marco. I had to do something else. So I didn't do my homework very well. you see? There is always something.
No, but I can do that if you wish.
Daniëlla Dam de Jong is assistant professor at the Department of Public International Law and the Grotius Center for International Legal Studies at Leiden University. She has defended her PhD at the same university on a dissertation entitled International Law and Governance of Natural Resources in Conflict and Post-Conflict Situations, for which she received a research prize by the Foundation Premium Erasmianum and an honorary mention by the Max van der Stoel Human Rights Award. Max van der Stoel, a great personality, the first High Commissioner for National Minorities of the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, and former Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Netherlands. I had the honor to meet him and to work with him. The dissertation has been published by Cambridge University in 2015, and it is the book we're going to discuss today. Daniëlla is interested in questions relating to the fields of sustainable development and peace and security, with a focus on the work of the United Nations Security Council. She is also a member of the International Law Association Study Group on UN sanctions and international law. And now I think I can give you the floor. I'm sorry.
Thank you very much. So let me begin on a personal with a personal note, which is I'm really delighted to have you here, also because we've been studying, I think, more or less the same issue for some years, and I've been on the tracks of Daniëlla on the internet, googling her works, and basically also this is a moment, an important moment for me, because I'm coming to terms with this idea that was the book I should have written. So now it's the moment. I have that one, but that one should have been translated into English, and it never happened. Anyway, this is a very important book in my view, for a number of reasons. So it will take really too much time to explain why it is important. But let me focus on one aspect. In my view, this book is at the same time innovative and very comprehensive, which is not an easy task. It is innovative because it builds upon the political science debate on the linkage between natural resources and armed conflicts, and it introduces a legal perspective into such debate. So this is a truly, I think, interdisciplinary approach, although what is being said here is extremely precise under a legal perspective. So, of course, we are lawyers, so Daniëlla is a lawyer, she is an international, she's a scholar of international law, but at the same time, she understands perfectly the debate in a political science perspective. So building upon such debate is extremely fruitful, because one might understand whether the law is a part of the phenomenon. The phenomenon is the linkage between natural resources and conflicts, and the so-called, as I'm sure you know, resource curse debate, or paradox of plenty. Why states that are so rich in natural resources could be relatively worse off with respect of other states that are not rich in natural resources? How come the richest country in terms of natural resources, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, is embroiled in a never-ending conflict? How can it be possible? So in this respect, we have had a very important political science debate and a relatively underdeveloped legal debate, and this book fills a gap. So it is a very important novel approach to this key subject, also in very practical terms, as everybody understands. Now, the book is very comprehensive, and it has an interesting structure, going from the perspective of subjects, and then approaching, after having summarized the debate on the linkage between natural resources and conflicts in a political science, in a very concise but effective way at the beginning, then the book approaches this perspective of actors involved in conflicts related to natural resources. And then, after that, a very comprehensive treatment all of the rules that are possibly related to this relationship, both in terms of a very general perspective on the most important rule on the allocation of natural resources, which is sovereignty and permanent sovereignty over natural resources, and then of course all of the subsequent developments in terms of the involvement of civil society, the Security Council, so both formal and informal intervention on the part of the international community in a very wider sense are examined, going from Security Council resolutions to the Kimberley process in a very comprehensive and at the same time detailed way. So this is a book I really like for these reasons. So, of course, this is not a book on indigenous peoples. Huh? So we are trying today, as mentioned by Professor Nesi, to discuss together a number of publications through the perspectives of indigenous peoples. So indigenous peoples are only a part of it, a part of the picture in Daniëlla's book, but it is an important part of the picture. So I think it is a nice angle to discuss a number of ideas put forward by Daniëlla. My first question now coming to our interview, my first question to Daniëlla is related to this perspective of subjects. So, because you're going through the actors that, according to your understanding, are involved in resource-related armed conflicts. And the thing that strikes me is that in the political science debate, there is something on the role of indigenous peoples within so-called resource conflicts. And for instance, one case is an example, the Borneo with, of course, international companies being escorted by the military, by the army, or by private security company, and exploiting and destroying the ancestral lands, the forest in which indigenous peoples are living, and indigenous peoples reacting, giving rise to a proper conflict. So my first question is, do you see also in legal terms a specificity in this typology of conflicts, when it ends up in violence on the part of indigenous peoples reacting to exploitation of natural resources in the terms we might easily describe? Do you see a specificity in legal terms? Do you see a value added in a legal study on this?
So first of all, let me thank the University of Trento for inviting me here, and especially Marco for making this possible, and he has tried to track me. I've been trying to track him, so it's very nice that we are finally able to meet. So as regards the question, maybe I can contextualize a bit. So international armed conflicts, armed conflicts relating to natural resources can take different forms. What I have been looking at mainly is the idea of natural resources financing an armed conflict. So we are looking at the blood diamonds in Angola, Sierra Leone, blood timber or conflict timber from Liberia, the conflict minerals from the DR Congo. So first of all, that already indicates that most of these armed conflicts are in Africa. So that automatically already had an impact on my study, because most of the conflicts that I have been looking at are, in fact, African conflicts. Second, so I've been looking both at international armed conflicts and internal armed conflicts, and I think there we start to get to the core of the question, because internal armed conflicts, for those of you who are not very familiar with international humanitarian law, have a certain threshold. We speak in legal terms of an armed conflict if it goes beyond the threshold of disturbances or simple violence. So an internal armed conflict is normally an armed conflict between armed groups and a government, or between armed groups themselves. So from that perspective, indigenous peoples as actors in these armed conflicts did not immediately come to my mind, because normally the violence does not evolve to the threshold needed for an internal armed conflict. But I think it is an interesting question nevertheless, because, I mean, indigenous peoples, obviously, one can think of situations where there might be an armed conflict that reaches this legal threshold, where indigenous peoples are one of the actors. So then they would qualify as an armed group, in fact. And then for the rules of international humanitarian law, you would look at them from that perspective and define the rules on whether they can use natural resources primarily from that perspective. So that is a start of a question or an answer to your question.
Okay. So at the basis of perhaps one of the loopholes that I think probably implicitly you identify in the political science debate, is that the way natural resources are allocated is not carefully studied. So it's often taken as a given. And in legal terms, the allocation of natural resources is probably the most important thing that international law does, allocating natural resources, at least classical international law. So, of course, this is premised, this is based on the idea of sovereignty. And this is the big issue for indigenous peoples, because recently the debate is revolving around this idea of attributing a form of sovereignty to indigenous peoples. So through the concept of permanent sovereignty over natural resources, which was, of course, was born in a completely different context, partially different context, this is debatable, now applied to indigenous peoples, so there is a view according to which indigenous peoples would be on an equal footing or on a similar situation with respect to states. So a form of sovereignty over natural resources on indigenous peoples. What do you think? Do you agree? What is your position with respect to this important debate?
The first answer is a very short one. No, I do not agree. I do think that indigenous peoples certainly have particular rights, which also define the relationship between states and indigenous peoples when it concerns to lands and natural resources. From the perspective of international law, I actually, this is not my original contribution, because I actually follow the work of my supervisor, Nico Schrijver, who distinguishes between subjects and objects in that sense. And permanent sovereignty is primarily a principle that was that comes from the whole decolonization debate, and that is something about allocation of natural resources at two states. Subsequently, the principle has evolved. Now, and that is something that I do argue, it does have relevance for the relationship between states and the people within those states. But that is not a relationship in the sense of that there might be different subjects within the states who might have permanent sovereignty over natural resources. It is more that the state is a sort of abstract entity. The government represents the state. So the government normally exercises sovereignty over the natural resources for the state. But when exercising this sovereignty, the government has certain obligations internally. And one of these obligations relate to respect for indigenous people's rights. I think also a very important difference is, if you look at the legal framework and why indigenous people's rights are protected when it comes to natural resources, that is very much related to the right to enjoy their own culture, as articulated in Article 27 of the ICCPR. And so there is a different focus as well there. So in terms of subjects of permanent sovereignty, no, I would not agree, but they are certainly beneficiaries in that sense. So the government has a right to exploit natural resources, but it must do so for the benefit of the people living in the state, so also for indigenous peoples, and the special relationship that indigenous peoples have with lands and natural resources makes that they have additional rights that the government must respect. So in that sense, I think it's mostly a question of obligations of the state through the government towards indigenous peoples within the state.
So if we can continue on this, your opinion is based on the understanding of state practice as not accepting permanent sovereignty over natural resources on the part of indigenous peoples. So it's state practice not revealing that states are ready to accept this. Is that a theoretical point you're making, or are you analyzing the practice, or are you interpreting the resolutions, the relevant resolutions? What is the basis of?
I think it's also a more fundamental divide, because permanent sovereignty as such is linked to state sovereignty. A state has sovereignty over its natural resources. Well, what we're talking about when we're talking about indigenous peoples is more the right to self-determination, which is a human right. And if you look at the Common Article 1 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, which embodies the right to self-determination, it does have an economic component, which is the right to freely dispose of natural resources. So to that extent, the two are interlinked, because sometimes it is also said, well, the right to economic self-determination is in fact a sort of translation of permanent sovereignty, but I think the legal basis is different. So from that perspective, the right to self-determination does accrue to indigenous peoples to some extent, and also from that, that is a right, a human right, which is to be exercised against the state. So it is a different relationship, I think.
Mm-hmm. And my last point on this, because it's truly interesting. And do you think some sort of analogy, say, people under a classical understanding of permanent sovereignty, having permanent sovereignty, are people subject to colonization? So isn't it, in the case of indigenous people, yet just another form of decolonization? Because we accept it. We accept it for Western Sahara. It's settled. They have permanent sovereignty over natural resources. But we don't accept it for, say, people of the Borneo. But isn't it a form of colonization that we're subject to? So the same situation qualified by the same rule.
That is a very tricky question.
Isn't it that the Indonesians were truly colonizing the people of the Borneo? Because we're actually controlling just the coast. Mm-hmm. And it's very similar to what happened to between Europeans and non-Europeans.
Yes, I mean, to some extent you can say the principle of permanent sovereignty arose in the decolonization debates and had belonged to new states. But still, the point is that it belongs to states, permanent sovereignty. So when it comes to other entities, I really prefer to frame it in terms of self-determination. And there, the question where you touch upon to some extent is also, do indigenous peoples have a right to maybe even external self-determination, if you compare them to colonial peoples. And then I would say that is a hotly debated issue if you also look at the Kosovo opinion and when do minorities have a right to external self-determination, and that is a question that is not settled. But if you look at how international law has treated this thus far, is that it's if indigenous peoples have a right to self-determination, it's a right to internal self-determination. So that means self-government within the confines of the sovereign states. So any rights that are related to self-determination would boil down to internal self-determination, so forms of self-government. And that is something that is relevant for the situation you describe, Indonesia, Borneo, these kinds of situations.
Thank you. There is a point in your book, which is of course paragraph 2.4 of the second chapter, in which you take position and say that there is a trend based on a number of elements that you carefully describe towards a people-oriented concept of permanent sovereignty. So in a way, your position is traditional. You say permanent sovereignty pertains to states, but then you take an innovative approach, and the approach is it pertains to rather innovative approach, but can be discussed. Then it pertains to governments, but governments must exercise their permanent sovereignty in a people-oriented, under a people-oriented perspective. Could you develop, explain, because this is, I think, delicate and interesting at the same time.
Yeah, so when originally the principle of permanent sovereignty was coined in General Assembly resolutions, one of the conditions that was formulated was that natural resources should be exploited for the benefit of the people. So that is the core of this people-oriented conception of permanent sovereignty. So states and thus governments have a right to exploit natural resources, but they must do so for the benefits of the population of the states, huh? Or for different peoples within the state. Then at a certain point, this whole idea of permanent sovereignty was framed more in terms of assertions of developing countries towards investment protect, or sorry, had a right to nationalize more into investment law. So it became more entrenched into a sort of state debate. So this condition disappeared somewhat from these resolutions. So that some at a certain point argued that maybe it was permanent sovereignty was purely a state question, and that peoples did not have so much to do with it. But then at a certain point, what you see is that this condition is reintroduced in newer instruments. I have to say, the instruments that I mention, as such, there are too few to really conclude that the principle of permanent sovereignty should be interpreted as for the benefit of the people. There are some Security Council resolutions explicitly related to this idea of resource conflicts, for example, related to the DR Congo and the conflict there, where the Security Council expressly states that natural resource should be exploited for the benefit of the population. Also in relation to Liberia, where the Security Council even goes one step further, where it actually conditions at a certain point the whole idea of taking away the sanctions on whether the government complies with using the natural resources for development, for the people. And so there are some other instruments which also contain indications that that natural resource should be exploited for the benefit of the people. Another are some African instruments, human rights instruments, which frame this, and some peace treaties. But peace treaties or peace agreements are, in that sense, a bit more shaky, because do they actually state the law, or is it just a practical solution for the conflict? So that is a bit more shaky. But I think from these instruments you see a sort of focus towards reorienting the concept of permanent sovereignty, so that it is so that peoples are beneficiaries, so not subjects but certainly beneficiaries of this principle.
And that includes indigenous people.
And that includes indigenous peoples, certainly.
Within this idea of...
Yes, certainly.
So within the population of the state is indigenous people.
Yeah, but then indigenous peoples, they are a bit more special because they have additional rights.
Okay, related to this, this is my last point, the tricky relationship between indigenous peoples and other groups. So, of course, local communities, Mauro Barelli mentioned peasants. So how do you see this relationship? Is it can we take the view that the indigenous peoples are playing in this respect, the whole debate is playing a positive role in the sense that this is a model, and then other groups that are non-dominant, because probably that is the main feature, they are non-dominant within society, other groups might follow, no? And might be empowered by this debate on indigenous people, and realize that for non-dominant groups, relationship with natural resources is key for being empowered. So realizing this through indigenous peoples might be important for future development. Another perspective could be the opposite. They are playing a negative role because they are hegemonizing the debate. The whole debate is about indigenous peoples, which is only partially true because, of course, But indigenous peoples are playing a negative role because we are only talking about them, and there are other issues that are important and we should be discussing them equally. And perhaps the key issue is understand how natural resources are allocated within society and think about it without a specific framework in terms of environmental democracy. That's the key. Huh? How do we allocate resources within the state? And then, of course, there are specific groups and not just one typology, huh? Several typologies. So what do you think?
I think it's a mixture in that sense. I think indigenous peoples and the debates over their rights over natural resource can play a very positive role in the sense that it is established that there is a close relationship between peoples living in certain areas and natural resource. On the other hand, they are obviously a very specific group, or they are specific groups in the sense that their whole lifestyle is dependent on natural resources. So at a certain point also in the book, I make the point that if you look at the general comments, etc., of the human rights bodies, of the two most important, the 1966 covenants, what they say is that the right to self-determination in Article 1, in order to make that right effective, that states should establish procedures that make it possible in practice to exercise self-determination. And one of the issues that I identify there is that it is very important that local communities have a role in decision-making. What I find is interesting is, in the general comments, those two committees speak both of indigenous peoples and of local communities. But when you look at the case law, if I can call it case law, that focuses exclusively on indigenous peoples. So that might give the idea that only when indigenous peoples are concerned that states should have have an obligation to consult, for example. Well, I think, especially if you look in certain countries, as such as in Africa, where the local community, not being indigenous, is also very dependent on the available natural resources just to earn a living, it might be just as important, and the nature surrounding it, it might be just as important to give them a say in certain projects as it is for indigenous peoples. Although I do recognize that the rationale is different and that indigenous peoples have a particular relationship with nature and with the lands they live on, that makes it particularly important to consult them on what is going to happen with their lands. So, positive and negative.
Thank you. Chair? Another one? Can I?
Okay. No, just otherwise we're going to generalize.
Okay, so I will ask it later on, perhaps in the general.
Okay. But now we have
Thank you very much.
We have a 5-10 minutes Q&A from the public, from the floor. So if there is any question, please introduce yourself. Professor Togliatti.
Thank you very much, Roberto Tognatti. For the last 4 to 5 years, I've been interested in the rights of the indigenous peoples, although from a different perspective, which is the one of comparative constitutional law, and also in a different theater, because I'm mostly concerned with the rights of indigenous peoples in Latin America. And I find the situation quite different there. And I would like to have a comment from you on the difference. For instance, in Latin America, of course, that is also an area of great violence and also government-sponsored violence. But I don't think that we can have as much as armed conflict situation as in Africa. But also, what makes it quite relevant, I would say, is that because of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, the issues of indigenous people's rights have been juridicized to a much larger extent, I think. And in fact, we have, I would say, not less than 25 decisions by the Inter-American Court of Human Rights on issues concerning the rights of indigenous peoples over the land. And in particular, I refer to two things here. First, the framework there is not of sovereignty over the land, but property, bare property. And this is recognized also by many recently amended constitutions in Latin America. So the issue is property, and the Inter-American Court of Human Rights acknowledges and deals with issues within the framework of property, which seems to me to be much more legal, if you like, and perhaps also much more concrete and justiciable in a way. The second thing which I find interesting, as it is quite distinct from Africa, although you made a reference to this in your very final word, I would say, I find it terrific that the Inter-American Court of Human Rights elaborates the spiritual meaning of land property to the indigenous peoples, so that the land is not only the ways for providing a livelihood, but it's also connected with worship and with the very identity of the group. So I would say it seems to me that in Latin America there is a more elaborated elaboration of the issue, precisely from the point of view of law, perhaps also international law, whether it is soft or hard, I don't know. But certainly there is a significant contribution by constitutional law. So this is quite distinct. And I wonder if you, because you're an expert, if you have ever tried to elaborate the reasons for the distinction between Africa and Latin America. I don't want to mention Asia, but certainly Africa is losing with regard both to Latin America and Asia. So perhaps this is one of the reasons why Africa is so much in need of attention, sympathy, support, whatever. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there any other intervention? Any other question?
Maybe I can answer this question first. Yeah. Two questions. So first, the one about property in relation to natural resources. I don't think it's so much of a different framework in the end, because sovereignty is ultimately is about the allocation of natural resources to states. And the Inter-American system, because then you have the question of within states, to who does the right, to whom does the land belong? So there, the Inter-American system works with a property, something that the African system doesn't really know or recognize. So in the African system, the main idea is that you have a sort of derived sovereignty to some extent, where at least the African Charter recognizes a right to freely dispose of natural resources to peoples. And so there you have a sort of derived sovereignty, and also the right to development, which is important for indigenous peoples. So it's two different systems, but I think the sovereignty is still also present in the Inter-American system, at least as the basis for the allocation of natural resources. And then there is a system of property for the internal allocation. So to some extent, I think the systems are comparable. But you are right that they function in a different way when they look at rights of indigenous peoples over natural resources. The second question, I think, is a very, very important one, but also a very difficult one for me to answer, because I'm not a specialist in indigenous peoples as such. So maybe I may defer that question to you, actually. Because to really compare the spiritual value of lands, which is much more present in the Latin American system than in the African system, I think you probably have more knowledge of that, or maybe Elisa, than I have. Yeah, or maybe later after you present it. Yeah.
We could also make it quite
because the structure of our meeting was from the general to the specific, and now we have.
I think I think you're right, and clearly this has happened through the judicial activity of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, which has, as you put it, like judicialized the issue in a very articulated manner. So. This idea of the spiritual connection, special cultural connection the indigenous peoples have with their land is very visible in Latin America because of this. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's not present in Africa, at least in terms of international law. We have few decisions, but you know, one important decision of the African Commission on Human and People Rights in the Ndori case, pretty much really copy-paste huge bit of the jurisprudence of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights on indigenous people. So we are seeing perhaps a cross-fertilization process now taking places between Latin America, the Inter-American system, and the African system. But I would still agree, though, with your starting point that the Inter-American system is playing another league. It's like the Champions League as opposed to the Serie A, the National League. So they've been dealing with indigenous people rights for so many more years. The indigenous population within each individual country are so more active internally, politically. They're so more powerful. They have more resources. And therefore, as a result of all these factors, that's why the Inter-American system is the leading system in terms of indigenous people rights. If this answer goes in the direction of answering.
Thank you. This is one of the possible answers, maybe. if there is no other request for the floor, I would thank again Daniëlla and Marco, and invite here Mauro, together with Paolo and Elena.
Cosa?
Se vuoi bere. Lei non ha toccato. Poi, ma no, loro comunque cambiano.
No, ma lasciate questo.
Perché lo so. Vabbè. Okay, so we go on, and now I have the pleasure to introduce Mauro Barelli. Mauro is director of the PhD program of the City Law School in London, where he teaches public international law and international human rights law, and also runs a course on minority and indigenous peoples' rights for LLM students. Previously, he taught at Cardiff University, where he also obtained his PhD in 2012, has been a visiting fellow at the Lauterpacht Center for International Law of the Cambridge University, and has guest lectured at the University of Iceland and the University of Nanjing in China. His research interests especially lie in international human rights law. He is particularly interested in interdisciplinary approaches to the study of minority groups' rights, as we have seen, in particular indigenous people's rights, the right of self-determination and global justice, topics on which he has written extensively, including the monograph on the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples we are discussing today. So, Mauro, I give immediately the floor to Elena. And let me introduce, since this is the first official appearance of Elena Fasoli, I have really the pleasure to introduce her to the public. Elena comes from Queen Mary University, London. Now she's one of our research assistants or professor assistants here in Trento since last November. And we are very pleased that she joined us. She's a specialist in environmental law, and she's also a member of the UNEP Commission on I don't know what, but she's going to explain maybe. And we are very happy that that she joined our faculty. Paolo Turrini is already well known by this university, maybe not by everybody in the public, but Paolo is teaches international law at the Faculty of Sociology here in Trento. He got his PhD in Bologna, in Florence, I'm sorry, at the European University Institute, after his law degree in Bologna. So, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Professor. So, also for the kind introduction. Okay, so I would start to describe the book by Mauro by saying that I think that there is no need to say that the literature and publications on indigenous peoples, it's absolutely vast and extensive. But I think that your book, this book that you wrote, is one of the few books, if we exclude the pile of edited books on the subject, is one of the few that addresses specifically the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, adopted in 2007. As you can see from the table of contents, maybe table of contents, the book, in fact, it addresses the declaration and it focuses on the declaration specifically, addressing in a comprehensive way all the different aspects. You talk about the drafting history, you talk about the legal content, the legal status. Also the significance of the declaration even beyond the indigenous peoples groups, and also the reasons behind this adoption of the UN Declaration. The research question that you follow in the book is whether the adoption of the 2007 UN Declaration on Indigenous Peoples, it points to the existence of an international law that provides or promises, at least to provide, valid responses to the demands of justice of disempowered, vulnerable peoples, not only indigenous peoples, as I was saying. And you say, in substance, in the book, that, well, it did international law answer or provide a valid response to indigenous peoples' rights. But the same cannot be said to other groups, with regard to the other groups that you are analyzing in the book. And that's another interesting and important feature of your book, that you have been selecting three cases and illustrative examples. Peasants, that Marco mentioned at the beginning, homeland minorities, and Roma, to see if international law answered their questions for justice. In any case, you say, whether these other groups, different from indigenous peoples, will be able to succeed in this struggle for a higher level of protection, and I quote you, will depend on the dynamics and circumstances of their own struggles. And you say also, and international law can hardly be expected to consistently provide valid responses to these groups' needs and aspirations. You conclude the book in this way. So, in light of this introduction, my first question to you is this one. Are you an optimist or a pessimist? Not in general. Not in general, exactly. Wait. Let me explain, because otherwise. Okay, so as we know, there are commentators that Will Kimlicker is one of these commentators, and that, well, I will call him a pessimist in this case. Well, he has pointed out that there is a risk that this unbalanced level of protection that the indigenous peoples and homeland minorities have separately achieved, this unbalanced level, especially with the minorities more and more, he says, labeling themselves as indigenous peoples in order to get actually a higher level of protection. He says, well, in the long run, this could diminish actually the value of the declaration, and I quote him, this is likely to lead to the collapse of international system of indigenous rights. So he's quite pessimistic about this. That's why he also talks about a rethinking of the categories of indigenous peoples and minorities. Next to this, I would call the more optimistic approach, for example, Stephen Allen. They think that the endorsement of the indigenous people's rights by the declaration, by the UN, well, is progressively empowering the claims of other groups, of other challenged groups. So my question to you is this. Where do you position yourself in this debate? Do you think that there is the need to rethink about this distinction? Do you see that there is such a risk or not?
Thank you. Thanks for the question. Again, before answering, I would like to echo Daniëlla and thank again the University of Trento for inviting me here, and especially Marco for organizing, arranging everything. And well, it's a very good question, which goes at the core of the book that we are discussing today. And I would say, using your terminology, which, you know, is quite useful actually, that in this respect, there are more optimists, or there have been more optimists than pessimists. So I think that the conventional answer or approach to this question in the literature has been the adoption of the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People as signal a new era in the field of ethnocultural group rights. So now indigenous peoples have obtained some remarkable achievement, legal achievement in terms of rights. Just to give a few examples, we could talk about the right to self-determination, extensive land rights, very strong consultative rights, supported by the principle of free, prior, informed consent, which potentially could all be enjoyed sooner or later by other groups similar to indigenous people. So for this reason, the declaration has been, you know, described as a triumph for justice, for human dignity, something which could potentially change, or has already changed, international law, and the way in which international law treats ethnocultural groups. So I tend to side more with Kimlicker, or the pessimist, as you say, for a number of reasons. So Kimlicker mainly focuses on one factor, which is political realism. So Kimlicker argues, practically, and I'm oversimplifying, but he says the only reason why indigenous people were recognized as beneficiaries of the right to self-determination, for example, is because very few of them, if any, actually seek for external self-determination. Therefore, from the perspective of states, to agree on the fact that indigenous people may enjoy the right to self-determination was not too risky, because they knew actually what they were talking about was internal self-determination. Now, the same is not true with regard to national minorities, because Kimlicker argues state will never agree on a text, on an international law text, which expressly recognized the right to self-determination to minorities, to national minorities, because quite a few of these minorities actually do seek independence. They do seek external self-determination, A, and B, they have the political and financial power and capacities to achieve independence. Therefore, Kimnica argues, you know, we need to be realistic. You know, what has happened with the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People will not necessarily translate in huge benefits for other ethnocultural groups, especially national minorities. He's mainly concerned with national minorities. And I think this is a good argument, but it's just one of the reasons, one of the potential reasons that needs to be added to the equation. So it's not only political realism which can explain the declaration. If it was only because of that, then how can we explain the recognition of strong land rights to indigenous peoples? When you combine the regime on land rights of indigenous peoples with free prior informed consent, consultative rights, then you can end up, as we were discussing this morning during the Viva, the PhD Viva, in a situation in which a state may actually be prevented from exploiting natural resources found within its own territory if the indigenous people or the indigenous community affected disagree with this course of action. So clearly this cannot be in the interest of state. So still in the declaration we find something which, you know, potentially challenge state interest as opposed to the argument on self-determination. So I think there are a few other factors which needs to be added. And in the book I talk about a number of these factors. Maybe today for the reason of time, maybe I can just refer to one. Which is, I think it distinguishes quite importantly the way in which indigenous peoples as actors have mobilized, have organized themselves as opposed to national minorities or the Roma, to a different extent peasant. So we can talk maybe about that later. But effectively what has happened internationally is that indigenous peoples have been able to mobilize as a movement, as a global social movement. So they have tried for many years, and they have achieved to a significant extent to speak with one voice, to liaise with state as representative of themselves, without the medium of third parties, without the medium, for example, of European NGOs, right, just to give an example. Homeland minorities and the Roma have not been able to do this. So they've not really been very efficient, very effective in lobbying states internationally as well as regionally in Europe, when we look at national minorities in Europe, to lobby state, to persuade state strongly to agree on certain strong language, on strong language in any international relevant instrument. So I think this is another reason which tend to distinguish these ethnocultural groups, indigenous peoples on the one hand from the national minorities and the Roma on the other. And I think that the example of peasant, this is happening as we talk, so you know, I'm still very, very curious to see what will come out of this. But quite interestingly, peasants are trying to emulate exactly what indigenous peoples have done. So they are organizing themselves as a global movement, led to a significant extent by La Via Campesina, and they are trying to represent themselves as peasant, as to self-represent themselves. They are trying to use the same language as well, which is being used by indigenous people representatives at the UN, and they are trying to use the same legal strategies. They are trying to get a declaration in the same way in which indigenous people did. So I think this is an additional reason, perhaps, to be pessimistic. Now, maybe pessimistic now is not... yeah, exactly. Right. Trying to be realistic. And I thought there was a need to, you know, to be a bit more realistic about what actually the implications of this document can be beyond indigenous peoples.
Right. Thank you so much. So let me see if you agree with Kimnica also on another point. The success of indigenous peoples' rights. At the UN level, he says, well, he agrees with other commentators that say that The declaration could also and could have opened the door and progressively opened the door not only to those other groups that you just mentioned, but also more widely to other groups, social movements devoted to social justice, devoted to global democracy. Let's think about, for example, women's rights or environmental groups. So do you think that the declaration could have an impact also in such a wider, in a wider perspective?
Yes, yeah? And especially in these more generic or loose terms, it can certainly have an impact because now it's there, it has been adopted, it's part of international law. There is, of course, the debate whether it's hard law, soft law, and with all the implications, but it's there, it exists. And therefore, this kind of implication are real. Right? You don't have to be pessimistic about this. You know, in this sense, yes, the declaration can have important consequences for human rights generally, the human rights movement generally. The first question, though, is a bit more specific. So it referred to direct, very visible, immediate consequences. That, I think, is much more difficult to achieve.
Thanks. So I would give the floor to Paolo. That has other questions for you. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for being here, especially the students, despite their many commitments. And, of course, many thanks also to Professor Barelli, which is available to be at our disposal. Under this crossed fire, because this is the only session that has two discussants. I mean, this is a deluxe session. And
try to avoid friendly fire between you.
No. It's Elena is safe. Friendly fire. My set of questions revolve around the topic of the legal status of the declaration. I would like to make a disclosure because, Marco, may I? Because until 2 days ago, the format was meant to be quite different, and Professor Barelli was meant to discuss two chapters of his book, chapter 2 and chapter 3. On the legal content and the legal status of the declaration, and I immediately chose to speak about to comment upon the legal status. And irrespective of the format, I think I would have chosen in any case this topic because I think it is at the heart of a problem. Because since the approval of the declaration in 2007. Was met with enthusiastic comments. It was hailed enthusiastically by many, but it was also criticized by some, in my opinion, with some reasons, because of its soft law character. In fact, the declaration is just a declaration, a mere act of soft law. And it remains after 10 years. And of course, it gathered a big amount of consent, many votes in the General Assembly, but also some dissent of some weight. Some countries, Canada, New Zealand, Australia, and the United States voted against the declaration in 2007, although they recently took the opposite stance and came to support the declaration. This is taken into account in the book, of course, which is very recent because it was published last year. But I think that this change of mind on the part of these four states, which are quite important states because they have many they have a great component of indigenous population in the within their territory. They change mind, but just to a limited extent, and maybe to no extent, because I tried to read the declaration with which they released when they officially stated their support for the declaration, and they found something interesting, in my opinion. I would like to stress a couple of points. This is true for United States, Australia, and New Zealand, because it seems that Canada has accepted wholeheartedly the declaration, at least judging on the words of the Canada's representative. Australia said in 2007 that with regard to the nature of the declaration, it is clear intention of all states that it be an aspirational declaration with political and moral force, but not legal force. It is not intended itself to be legally binding or reflective of international law. Then, a couple of years ago, I think, when it changed position, Australia said that the declaration is historic and aspirational. While it is not binding and does not affect existing Australian law, it sets important international principles for nations to aspire to. And so the tone of these two stances is very similar. In each case, what is said is this. The declaration is an aspiration. We have to aspire to the principles set forth in the declaration, but it is not binding. So they vote for the declaration and they vote against the declaration by using the same words. This is, in my opinion, quite strange, quite telling of something. And New Zealand has done something similar on a different point. And I quote again some passages. In the past, in 2007, New Zealand said, New Zealand has been implementing most of the standards in the declaration for many years. We have difficulties with a number of provisions in the text. Four provisions in the declaration are fundamentally incompatible with New Zealand's constitutional and legal arrangements. With the Treaty of Waitangi, which is an important treaty dealing with indigenous affairs. And recently, it took another stance, which is not so another, because it said, in moving to support the declaration, New Zealand both affirms those rights and reaffirms the legal and constitutional frameworks that underpin New Zealand's legal system. And so this legal system, which is reaffirmed strongly before and after, is compatible or not with the principle? In the first, in 2007, it seemed two words apart, and now, on the contrary, this seems mutually supportive. The impression is that the constitutional setting of New Zealand remained the same, and what changes is the meaning that New Zealand wants to give to the declaration. That is, we support the declaration, but in any case, we want to interpret it according to our laws. In this case, too,
Paolo,
I think...
May I ask you something?
Yeah.
Is the type of government they had in New Zealand in 2007 the same as...
No, they changed government in each case, in any of these cases. And this is another point I think that is what would be worth of being analyzed, because the wholehearted acceptance by Canada of this declaration, I think, has much to do with politics than with legal matters. And so my first question is twofold. What do you think about this, what I have already just said, that is the fact that this act of soft law may be supported or fought against by using the same arguments? And the other part of the question is, don't you think that the decision to have a formal and an open vote in the General Assembly of this declaration may have backfired against indigenous people, because this made manifest, gave the opportunity to countries like New Zealand, Canada, Australia, and the United States to manifest their dissent. And this could have prevented maybe the emergence of a custom on this issue, because absent this manifest dissent, maybe would have been room to assume that the custom was there.
Yeah. So yeah, that's a very, very good question, or two questions. Again, this really it's a very important theme, which again we were discussing this morning. And before I articulate a bit more on the question of the legal status of a declaration, what I've always thought myself when I read this kind of statement of endorsement or any kind of declaration the state made at the time of adoption of a declaration is that, you know, when I read this statement, I can see the fear of state. So if we all agree that this is just soft law, which counts nothing, if we all agree about this, then why would they be so worried that they would write such long statement of endorsement, being extremely careful with their own legal team about what they write, how they put things, in order to prevent the declaration from having any kind of legal effect? So this in itself already tells me something. But the legal status is a huge point. It has created a lot of anxiety, not just among state, but also among commentators. And that's why you have some have taken the route of customary international law by saying, you know, okay, since this is just a declaration, it's not legally binding, we need something stronger, and therefore we need to make the argument that at least the key provisions of the declaration can be seen as customary international law, therefore being legally binding on states. Now, this is a controversial argument, with which I don't necessarily agree. I think it is a bit difficult to argue that some provisions of the declaration has achieved the status of custom in international law. But that's one argument which, to a significant extent, was made necessary by the lack of binding force of the declaration. Then you have those who say, you know, the declaration is just a political statement, which, however, I think it is an understatement, for the reason which I'll explain now. So I think that, you know, there shouldn't be any worry in recognizing this is a so-called soft law document. There are no problem in recognizing this, because soft law documents have the capacity under certain circumstances to produce very important legal effects and actually to make a difference on the ground. And I think we have seen this with the declaration. And there are a number of examples. Perhaps the most visible one, actually also going back to the question which was asked in the previous panel, judicial bodies, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, for example, the African Commission on Human and People Rights, human rights treaty bodies, even national, even domestic tribunals, domestic courts, actually have made express references to the declaration and to some specific provisions of the declaration, treating it almost as a treaty, even though it is not. So clearly the fact that this was soft law has not prevented very authoritative bodies, such as, for example, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, from developing its own jurisprudence on indigenous people rights, by referring, by expanding, by adjusting its reasoning on the basis of the provision of this declaration. So if we look at these dynamics, the way in which the declaration has been judicially significant, then without dismissing altogether this statement, because of course these are important ones, but then you see that these statements, you know, perhaps are not that relevant. In as much as judicially, both domestic, regional, and international bodies are willing to use the declaration and to implement it either directly or indirectly within their own pronouncement. And there are some very, very good examples of bodies. Now, the one which comes to my mind is the Committee on Elimination of Racial Discrimination, which I think was 2008, just 1 or 2 years after the declaration was adopted, in a concluding observation on the US, which had voted against and at the time had not endorsed it yet, still, in a section referring to the way in which the United States treat Native Americans, made a reference to the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, asking the US to try to interpret, to develop its own domestic laws on the basis of that declaration, even though that declaration is soft law, and B, the United States have voted against it. Mm-hmm. So I think you know, we can all understand why states had to use this language, why they had to make this statement, But at the same time, this does not prevent, ultimately, the declaration actually from being effective. And the second question was, okay, whether it backfired. Well, to answer properly this question, though, I need to ask you a question. Like, what do you have in mind? When you ask that question, do you have in mind as option B a treaty instead of,
no,
of a declaration?
Custom. Silence, pure silence, and maybe...
Okay.
Since there was already a lot of practice based on the previous convention, ILO convention number 169,
yeah.
Maybe that practice could be set to form the basis for a custom.
Yeah. Okay, I see. Because I thought you had in mind like a treaty. In that case, of course, a lot of problem. We would Well, okay, so that's probably an argument which would be supported by those who today try to make the argument of customary international law. But you know, as you may have gathered by now, I'm not a big fan of customary international law because of the difficulties. I think we all know the difficulties in establishing whether customary international law exists in the first place, and then how to establish exactly, for example, the land right regime. You know, all the complexity surrounding the issue of to what extent indigenous people own their land. To do this purely on the basis of custom would have been very problematic. And instead in the declaration, I never counted, but you know, there may be anything between 5 or 10 provisions specifically on land rights. That requires, and that is not enough, by the way. Things are still not very clear now. So. Personally, I don't think that simply relying on custom would have been a better solution because of these potential complications down the road.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I consider that you might have won round one, but now comes round two. No, on this very issue, I wouldn't like to seem monothematic, but it is a very important issue, in my opinion. And I would like to comment upon it, to expand and to make you expand the argument based on the international and international jurisprudence case law. Because there is a part in chapter 3 where you devote some attention to the international case law, which takes into account the UN Declaration. And I think, but this is an impression of mine, of course, I think that 10 years have passed since the approval of the Declaration in 2007. We have almost 10 years. And I think that case law making reference to that Declaration is quite scant and poor after 10 years. And you quoted some 3-4 judgments, and in one judgment of the European Court of Human Rights, the declaration is quoted by a dissenting judge. And in other two cases, Saramaka and Sarayaku of the Inter-American Commission of Human Rights, Commission, not Court of Human Rights. I try to with a search function of accurate reader to look at the places where the declaration is quoted, and I saw that in any case it's quoted among other things. For example, in Saramaka, before quoting the declaration, the court said, these safeguards, particularly those of effective participation and sharing of benefits regarding development and investment projects, are consistent with the observation of the Human Rights Committee, the text of several international instruments, and the practice in several states parties to the convention. So we have many conventions, a bunch of practice of states, and then so we can quote the declaration as an addendum, as an ad abundantiam. And in Sarayaku versus Ecuador, it works just the same because it is quoted always with and after the ILO Convention number 169. And so my impression is that in no case the declaration made a difference or added something or contributed to a different the rendering of a different judgment. And so this impression of mine is wrong, or there is something true in what I'm saying?
I think that there is something true to the extent that perhaps, you know, ideally we would have expected, we would have liked to see many more references being made to it, perhaps.
Yeah, because, sorry, but because also the absence makes sense, because I think that the importance of the declaration should be tested against the absence. So if in many cases referring and dealing with indigenous questions matters, the declaration is not quoted, even that absence is quite relevant, in my opinion.
Yes. Although, no, it's okay, it's a good point. Although, two things to consider. I said this before, but not I didn't emphasize this much. What I think is fair to say, I mean, of course, I cannot prove it, because it's not written down, but, you know, I think that it can be argued, easily be argued, that there are some courts, some bodies, which, without directly referring to the declaration, have actually been influenced by the content. So there might be a number of reasons why some courts may not want to expressly refer to the declaration, political reason, effectively. But if you take Canada, for instance, the Supreme Court of Canada has always been quite progressive with respect to the rights of indigenous peoples, especially with regard to the right to consultation. But recently, it has gone a couple of steps further. Pretty much following the model of FPIC, of free, prior, informed consent, which is embraced in the declaration, without, however, actually mentioning the declaration expressly in the text. So this was the one point I wanted to make. The other one, yes, you're right, especially in the case of the Inter-American system, there is, you will always find a reference to the ILO Convention 169. Main reason for this is that, you know, virtually, or the vast majority of Latin American states actually ratified that that convention, which, being a convention, therefore, is binding on them as a matter of international law. So does the declaration add something in those circumstances? Yes, it still does, because actually in a number of important respects, the declaration goes beyond ILO Convention 169. So ILO 169 has a good, quite a strong regime on land rights, but, for example, does not mention self-determination at all. In fact, in the preamble, even preempt any possible association between indigenous people and self-determination. Consultative rights are much weaker in ILO 169 than in the declaration. So to rely only on that text would not be enough for indigenous peoples.
Don't you think that the same outcome, the same development could be attained with the simple evolutive interpretation of treaties, because human rights courts do that all the time, and they make treaty rights evolve without making recourse to external instruments, or maybe by relying on external instruments, but just for rhetoric purposes.
This is an option. I think that the potential problem with this, and this is the reason why indigenous people themselves wanted the declaration, is that if you think in terms of strategic litigation, so in terms of actually indigenous people struggling for their own rights, initially domestically and subsequently at the international level. So one thing is to go before a court and say, well, we have the right to be consulted in good faith and with full respect of our principle of free, prior, informed consent, because the Human Rights Committee, in one pronouncement in 2015, with regard to Finland, said that, and the Committee on Elimination of Racial Discrimination, in a general comment of 2014, reflected that position. I'm oversimplifying. Okay? Quite another thing is to say, before a court, we do have these rights because Article 32 of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People has recognized that we do have these rights. So, in a sense, it is much better to have a document, an international law document, which we can use and which recognizes your rights. And that's the actually trying to link this with the initial question, while Kimlicka and to some extent me and other authors think that it is difficult to expect that state would agree on a new declaration on minorities. That there is also a United Nations Declaration on Minorities, early 90s. It is difficult to expect that this declaration will be amended or a new declaration will be adopted in order to align it with the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. But an indirect alignment could take place if treaty bodies started to interpret the provision on minority rights, taking into account the jurisprudence on Indigenous rights. But then states could challenge perhaps the legitimacy of this jurisprudence by arguing we have never agreed to anything like that in the 1992 Declaration on National Minorities.
Okay, thank you.
Good.
I would close, actually, with just a good news that could, I think, add to what we just said about the relevance of the Declaration. And the good news is that, I don't know if you know, but at the level of Latin American countries that have been quite sometimes actually mentioned, the United Nations Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, they are currently developing a new instrument on access to justice in environmental matters, public participation, so participatory rights in environmental matters. And actually the current negotiating text, it is referring to the declaration under the chapter on participatory rights and public participation in environmental decision making. So I think that it is good, following this reasoning, when you also say that there is a solid relationship between the content of the declaration and the norms, the standards, and the principles related to the indigenous peoples that are currently emerging at the international, in this case, regional Latin American countries level. So I think it's another element that should, you know, constitute a success for the declaration.
Yeah, yeah.
And thank you very much, by the way, for
thank you.
Listening to our questions. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any question from the floor? Elisa? Yeah, please.
Thank you very much to the whole panel. It's been a fascinating discussion. And perhaps one aspect of your book that we may not have discussed yet is the question of the legal content of the declaration. And I was wondering if we could just pick up on probably one of the most complex questions, the question of FPIC, free, prior, informed consent, and whether you could share with us your latest insights into how the declaration adds to what we discussed also this morning, a still quite unclear concepts in international law, and to what extent FPIC, in light of the declaration and practice inspired or more explicitly based on the declaration, how it differs from a more general duty to consult.
Thank you. Yeah. So, the principle of free, prior, informed consent is, I would say, one of the most important provision when it comes to the legal content of the declaration. I would say that indigenous people regarded the right to self-determination, land rights, and FPIC, strong consultative rights supported by FPIC, as the three main demands. Now, the problem with the declaration in this respect is that the language used in the relevant articles, and especially Article 32, is quite ambiguous. Right? So if you look at the original draft of the declaration, we can see that actually the initial provision pretty much recognized a right to veto, a quite a general right to veto to indigenous people, because the language of that provision was framed something like state must obtain the consent of indigenous peoples before going ahead with any plans affecting their ancestral land. The final version of the article instead became state must consult indigenous people in order to obtain their consent. Now, what does this mean? It's open to discussion, but definitely that the language has been downgraded from the original declaration and due to state opposition, obviously. Now, indigenous people still maintain that actually this would allow them to make decisions when plans or projects affect their ancestral lands and therefore their culture and their life. Article 32 of the Declaration, however, does not realistically say that. If this had been the case, then the original version of the article would have been adopted by states. So what we can, in order to try to provide a concrete answer to this very, very important question, we can look at the jurisprudence of treaty bodies or regional human rights courts, as we were also discussing today, which is not, this jurisprudence is not 100% coherent, I would say, if you look at the way in which each individual treaty bodies, Committee on Elimination of Racial Discrimination, Human Rights Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights have dealt with this issue, there are some differences among them. But I think that there is a trend, quite evident, visible trend among these bodies. This process has been led by the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, which has had the chance to articulate quite in some detail the land rights regime of indigenous people, including consultative rights. And I think that the overall agreement, the direction seems to be that if a relevant project is expected to make to produce a significant negative effect on the rights of indigenous people, on their territories, on their lives, then their consent must be obtained. Otherwise, the plan cannot go ahead. Now, does this answer the question? Only partially, right? Only partially. Yeah? It's a step in the right direction, but it does not solve all the problem, because then there is a question of who established the impact, the degree of impact that a particular project will have on the lands of indigenous peoples. There is the question of the cumulative effects of small scale project. But what I think is important to say, and sometimes people take this for granted, but it couldn't be taken for granted as part of the drafting process and the negotiation, is that actually the consent under certain circumstances must be sought. Because some state argue we don't even have to get the consent, we can just go ahead, full stop, without any restriction. That, I think we can fairly say that kind of action would be illegal under international law. At the same time, just to overcomplicate things, we cannot forget that there is always the issue of expropriation, which can take place lawfully under certain circumstances. So even the declaration recognized that the rights of indigenous people included therein are not absolute. But as I said before, some state and some interested actors were even arguing, well, we don't even have to try to seek the consent, we can just go ahead. So that is quite important that has been clarified. We still need to work on this, and perhaps there's something for you to do.
Yeah.
But
Thank you. I think that there has been a very interesting debate, and if there are no more questions, I would thank you, of course, and ask you please to go to your seat and invite Elisa Morgera and Alessandro Fodella to this table. Okay. So Elisa Morgera, Morgera, is professor of global environmental law and co-director of, this is almost impossible to pronounce, how do you say?
It's difficult to pronounce, yes.
So I don't want to make any great mistake, so I ask for your advice, how do you say?
Strathclyde,
Center for Environmental Law and Governance. She specializes in international, European, and comparative environmental law, with a particular focus on the interaction between biodiversity law and human rights, particularly those of indigenous peoples and local communities, equity and sustainability in natural resource development, oceans governance, and corporate accountability. She has also researched the environmental dimensions of the external relations of the European Union. She has been recently awarded a starting grant from the European Research Council to launch a research program on the topics of benefit sharing, the green economy, intergenerational equity, and the rule of law. Elisa's article we are discussing today is an output of this project. So I also introduce very briefly Alessandro. Alessandro is also at home here. He's, as you know, professor of international law, environmental law, and human rights. He's also an old friend of Elisa, and I give him the floor with pleasure.
Thank you so much, Peppe, and thank you for organizing this, also to Marco, obviously. That gives me the chance to do many things all at once. First, to put together two topics that I was very interested in ever since I was a student, basically. I had to choose to do my thesis when I was an undergraduate between the rights of indigenous peoples and environmental law, so here we go. The two things together. And obviously to meet up with an old friend, let's not say how old. Let me add, please, Pepe, I really would like to do so. By way of introduction, just a small anecdote about Elisa. So we know better, she's already smiling. Who is the person that we'll talk about this fascinating topic later. So we met when we were doing together a project, a bilateral cooperation project between Italy and Egypt on the reform of the Egyptian system on natural reserves, national parks. Correct me if I say anything wrong. And I went to Cairo a little bit earlier than Elisa, and the person responsible for the project, Professor Sergio Marchisi, was talking about Dr. Morgera, and she arrived one day, and we were given the task to prepare something with not a specific timeline. That's how the Egyptian worked, you know. Just you have to do this. And we went out for dinner. And I was sure the next day, you know, nothing would be done, really, because we were out for the night. And the morning we organized a meeting, and Elisa comes out with a perfectly drafted draft for the first assignment. And I thought, where does she come from? I mean, we were together having dinner, and where could she find the time? So this is just to say that Elisa is a very, very smart person, very fast thinking, and also what is particularly fitting for this venue, she combines the academic intellectual approach with a very, very practical approach, which is what Pepe was saying at the beginning. So, and that's also shown by the fact that she went on to work with FAO before then pursuing her brilliant academic career. And you see a pattern in that career, that's choosing universities that are difficult to pronounce, because that's also, there's also Edinburgh, and you know, you have to learn how to say
much
that.
Much easier Edinburgh than
that's true, but still, you know, one. You read it and then you have to know how to pronounce it. Anyways, to get more into the thick of things, Elisa has written this paper, Under the Radar, Fair and Equitable Benefit Sharing and the Human Rights of Indigenous Peoples and Local Communities Related to Natural Resources. It is a very dense paper which addresses the issue of benefit sharing under a new light, hence the Under the Radar part. And sorry, I should have said this from the outset, I have a flu, my voice is not 100%, so sorry for that. So the Under the Radar part is because what Elisa has tried to do is to fill those gaps in the doctrine about this idea, this concept, this tool, that of benefit sharing, relating to natural resources whenever indigenous and local communities are concerned. The concept, how it was originally envisioned, was mainly the idea of sort of compensation, this is the original sense, essentially a monetary one, and mainly when we were talking about bioprospecting, so having access and developing economic advantages from genetic resources. Now, that concept has evolved significantly. And what the paper by Elisa does is to look at how the same concept has been developed into human rights law, whereas before it was mainly within the realm of environmental law. And she has tried to see how the concept developed in the two different sectors can be interpreted in a mutually supportive way. That's where you find the conflict part of this conference. There's a common red line in Elisa's paper that is always trying to find where the frictions are, where the tensions are between different actors, between different normative areas, and how you can reconcile these frictions, these tensions. And also the other sort of innovative part is talking about natural resources in general, and again, not limited to bioprospecting. So the first question, I think we can start from there, is, by reading your paper, benefit sharing seems a concept that is so much beyond that traditional idea. So if you have sort of to map out how it has evolved, how would you explain that?
Yes, well, first of all, I would also like to start with thanks. It's great to be with old friends and great to be here at the University of Trento. It's my second visit and it's really a joy to be back and be again engaged in really interesting discussions. Also perhaps to explain the paper that has been, I think, circulated, it's also available online, it's still a working paper, and I think compared to the anecdotes that Alessandro has shared about me, one of the things I'm trying to do, I think thanks to the time and resources made available through the grant for this project, is to take more time to share my work, perhaps at early, more vulnerable stages of our thinking process, and get as much feedback as possible from experts they usually wouldn't necessarily meet or work together. So I'm very, very keen, and it's something that Federica has done as well with her work, to try and bring together communities of experts that may not necessarily talk sufficiently with each other in trying to understand the complexities of not only the evolution of international law, but also what we were just discussing, the different ways in which states see, implement, and talk with each other about international law. So benefit sharing, in a way, gives an opportunity to dig beyond the text and understanding why certain notions in international law may become quite diffuse, but not necessarily for the reason that they are better than others or more acceptable than others, but because they provide a vehicle for certain agendas to be pushed forward. And so in a way, the perception of what benefit sharing is about, be it only or more related to bioprospecting, or being more about monetary benefit sharing than about non-monetary benefit sharing, in a way is a reading of international law, but not one necessarily, not necessarily a complete reading of it. And part of the project, which I wish to underline, is a collective project. We have a team of three other researchers working with me very much in close collaboration. And I think without having at least four sets of eyes out there trying to understand connections, but also indications from different governments in different settings about what kind of very concrete problems and priorities are being pursued under the in implementing international law, I think we wouldn't have been able to find out what's happening under the radar. So in a way, what we're trying to do is bringing together, looking at arguments that are put forward in ongoing international negotiations. And for one thing, I think in every international instrument in which benefit sharing has been included, that was never the last word, but really the start of new negotiating processes, trying to understand how this idea can be concretized in international mechanisms, how it can be concretized in national legislation. But fundamentally, if and how that idea, which is often and I think now accepted as a formulation of fairness and equity in international law, how that can be achieved and whose view of fairness and equity has effectively been pursued through its application. And so the idea was really that to say, well, for how much there may be a dominant view, which may be based perhaps on how the practice on the ground is in effect occurring, different areas of development in international law show that perhaps that dominant view is not a complete picture of this concept. And for how much I think there is a very genuine and well-founded concerns about benefit sharing, not necessarily, even if the objective is that of achieving fairness and equity, not necessarily achieving those purposes or even entrenching certain power asymmetries and problematic dynamics in the protection of the environment and the protection of indigenous people's rights and other rights. There are elements in consensus text agreed internationally that bring in another dimension. And I think those elements have been picked up in the context of international and regional human rights bodies and processes. Now, this has been a very slow process. At some point, I thought I would just see what I wanted to see in there, but thankfully, the Inter-American Court has been much clearer in its most recent decisions that has confirmed that for how much this remains a contested concept and a concept where we really see a clash of worldviews, of views of what development is, what the relationships between governments and different communities within the population are. This is not just a concept that may be seen as a threat, but it's also a concept that has a lot of potential. And so the idea of this paper and of the project more generally is saying, what is the potential? Can we map the full potential of international law, of agreed text, be that hard or soft, to support a more constructive, good faith understanding of those different worldviews of the environment, of men in the environment, and of development that can bring to perhaps a negotiated solution or an acceptable solution to some of the challenges that may be related to, let's say, more specific questions of access to genetic resources, but even very old problems like sustainable logging or mining.
From reading the paper, what I see, and I obviously may be wrong, and that's for you to point out, it seems as if benefit sharing has it's like a complex, multifunctional tool that departs, at least as the way it has developed, from that original idea of being purely a compensatory mechanism for bioprospecting. So what's important from my point of view, that something that emerges clearly from your paper, is that it has become a way for indigenous peoples to be, indigenous peoples and local communities, and we will go back to that point, to be empowered in a way to own the process. So to get rid not only of the purely compensatory approach, but also of all the other paternalistic nuances that dominated the benefit sharing mechanism before. So can you elaborate on that, or how benefit sharing can actually be a mechanism that empowers these different communities?
Yes, no, thank you. And I think that that's probably the core of the potential of the concept in international law. In effect, benefit sharing has always been used internationally when we have a situation of clear power imbalances. And the idea of empowering the perhaps the most vulnerable parties in a certain discussion, and if we think of indigenous peoples and local communities, that's equally with regards to government actors as much as with regards to private sector actors. We have quite a lot of international material specifically on the latter relationship. The idea is that a little bit going back to the earlier discussion, when we have competing objectives, perhaps protected in international law, we have different rights which may require perhaps for a heightened level of protection. But in most cases, we're really in a situation where different rights and right holders and different objectives need to be somehow pursued at the same time, and without necessarily sacrificing one completely to another. So in some ways, my understanding of benefit sharing is that as opposed to one-off unilateral provision of certain advantages to a certain group with a view to, as you say, compensating for the loss of a right or a diminution of that right, it's really a dialogue where we try and understand, first of all, what different actors see as benefits, and that already, I think, opens up a whole rediscussions of whether a project is in the first place even desirable or not, and what the terms of the problem are. And then, again, an iterative process of understanding each other's positions, including perhaps legal positions, and there where the customary laws of indigenous peoples and local communities may come in, and perhaps a historic track record of those laws and understanding being having been sidelined by certain statutory instruments, and finding ways to create a genuine partnership. So I think partnership is really, again, a very contested and often a term that may be hegemonized or used for specific purposes. But the idea is that to say, well, we are looking at a situation where perhaps we can all have very important stakes, some protected more heavily in international law than others. We should all, at the very least, be equal in the discussion, in the understanding, and in the search of a culturally and socially and environmentally acceptable approach in certain circumstances. And I think what you mentioned in your question is key, the idea of the paternalistic approach that may be there, and the fact that for how much as international lawyer we look at international law as a neutral instrument, there is a history there, and there are conceptual approaches in it. They are not necessarily, and very clearly are not those of indigenous peoples and perhaps local communities. So there is already a disadvantage in having to use an instrument that comes from a different culture, perspective, ideology, and that perhaps even more so in the context of national law. So the idea is really that of trying to, by that discussion, not looking necessarily just of negative impacts, but positive impacts, the potential of benefits they may come from a genuine engagement, from an iterative engagement, and from an effort to consider different actors at the same level.
One of the most innovative elements that came from the Nagoya Protocol on benefit sharing was the idea of the possibility for local and indigenous communities to directly negotiate and enter into agreements with other actors, so-called community protocols, if I'm not wrong. And I remember you studying specifically this topic, and if I'm not wrong, also by going in the field. What can you share about that experience? These are not really much studied, so you are one of the few who knows on the ground if they are working, how they are working, what are the challenges in that respect?
Right. Well, thanks for that. And yes, the project has an empirical component, and whereas I don't think it would be fair to say we are socio-legal scholars, we are at least very keen to import as much understanding of local challenges into our own studies, which are mainly doctrinal studies of international law. And the decision about the case studies, which are in different regions of the world, different types of communities and natural resources, was led by the idea of looking at how community protocols, a discussion about the development of a tool from within the community with a view to create a basis for dialogue with external actors, be that governments or private sector or bilateral donors, perhaps very well-intentioned NGOs. So how that instrument can provide a translation or a building a bridge between what may be customary laws and rules, but also the community's own vision and values in a way that then can set the terms of the debate, at least from the community perspective. There are, of course, there's promises and risks with that, and we're still mapping that out. I think for one thing, one of the interesting things coming from our interdisciplinary work is that, on the one hand, the idea of an international treaty endorsing a community-based instrument, the protocol, as a basis for that foreseen dialogue between communities and the private sector and the government was seen as a victory, as an opening of the door to legal pluralism in international environmental treaty law. On the other hand, there may be a power dynamic there, and what if now communities are under more and more pressure to develop those protocols, whether the support they receive pushes them in perhaps engaging more than they wish or in terms that they don't necessarily fully share or haven't had the time to work out in terms of their implications, whether that becomes again an imposition into, instead of facilitating a process of dialogue, maybe an ulterior imposition on how they interact and if on their decision whether to interact with external actors. So I think the jury's still out there. I think what's interesting about community protocol is on the one hand this effort of giving voice to communities first into then a discussion that is really the intersection of international, national, transnational law. On the other hand, the fact that in many cases those protocols are actually quite difficult to negotiate, even the effort of making them accessible to external actors is a significant one. And so what we have seen is often communities, I mean, in most cases, communities do not produce those protocols by themselves. The process may be internal, but there's quite a lot of external support, be that from national or local government, be that bilateral donors, very often, if not international NGOs, but well-resourced and internationally active NGOs. So again, there's a question of how much that is a genuine equal partnership and how much that is truly an instrument for communities to express their voice and pursue their own priorities. I think that said, there's also an element, I think, of communities realizing that they may have to ask themselves who they are and what they want at a particular point in time, and communities are very, you know, varying time. We've been working with a community in Malaysia in the Barrio area where the changes have been incredible. There are pictures there of their grandfathers, parents, and sons where you wouldn't even see the resemblance in terms of lifestyle, in terms of opportunities, exposure to different processes. So the fact that the community protocol is also in a way an opportunity for communities to really discuss internally what is it that they want and perhaps what different members of the community want can be, again, an opportunity not just for external interaction but for self-reflection on internal governance.
I think that if I can just elaborate a little bit on that, it's a question that came to my mind because that's reflecting also my personal experience of research in the field. The doctrine tends to underline the potential frictions, tensions, you can call them however you want, between protection of the environment on one side and human rights on the other. And that's something that your paper also touches upon, reflects upon. But it does so mainly from the point of view what happens if a activity, a project that in theory is for the protection of the environment hinges upon human rights. You know, the ideal scenario, the classic case is what if a state establishes a protected area and obviously forcibly removes peoples, including their indigenous and local communities at large. From my personal experience, I start to see also sort of the other side of the coin in that scenario. That is, what if the state, decides to do something that's for the protection of human rights, that's detrimental to the environment? So the example that comes from my personal research is a recent decision by Tanzania to to upgrade a road inside a very important national park, the Serengeti National Park, which is also a common heritage according to the 72 UNESCO Convention. And that's also because local communities have asked so. So how do you reconcile those positions? Maybe it's a provocative question, not necessarily something you have elaborated on in the paper, but I sincerely would like to know what you think about.
Yeah, and I think it's something that also we discussed this morning. I mean, there is a danger there of assuming that indigenous peoples and local communities would automatically be in favor of further or enhanced environmental protection. And the question there is that, well, that may be the case. And again, for how much we may have cases where conservation measures have hindered or even completely undermined the protection of human rights, I think, again, one of the interesting potential and promises of a mutually supportive interpretation is rather amplifying protection of human rights where indigenous or local communities have contributed to environmental protection, and not just at the local level, but very much recognizing the contribution to global human well-being. And I think our own understanding of how local environmental processes may contribute to our own, to global health or to global food security, thinking, for instance, of the example of good management of pollinators and how our own survival on Earth depends on whether bees are around or not, and how their survival depends on very concrete decisions about how you pursue agricultural activities and so on. I think that there's a great potential there when in practice there is a history or there is a concrete effort by communities to protect the environment, to truly recognize that and through that amplify protection. Now, on the other hand, the question is, of course, that's not just a matter of recognition. I mean, from an international law perspective, states have obligations that derive from different sources. And the question is then, well, who's, of course, states are accountable to that, and their own decision-making needs to balance not only the protection of a certain group, but also the protection of general interests, if not, to some extent, global or very diffuse interests. So for how much, I think a lot of the literature has really focused on how the environmental argument can be misused to undermine protection of indigenous people's rights and communities' rights. And to some extent, the real risk there is that, again, we may have different worldviews of what protection of the environment is, different conceptions of how we can, as humans, can contribute to conservation or sustainable use. But there are also cases where communities may very well, for whatever reason, be against environmental conservation and may possibly pose a threat to the human rights of others that may be damaged by environmental degradation. So I think that's perhaps, I think, the core of national sovereignty over natural resources. At the end of the day, for how much governments may be the problem from a human rights perspective, they're also our only accountable actor, or the mainly accountable actor for looking after the multiplicity of goals that international law is protecting?
Yeah, thank you so much for the answer. I think accountability is really the key word here, because from two different points of view. One is, as much as we say that indigenous peoples, I don't obviously agree in principle on that, should be empowered, should have ownership of the development process, partially or not, that depends on your view. We also don't have to forget that with ownership, with responsibility, should come also accountability. So states are accountable. Obviously, the mechanism for states' accountability may not be perfect, but it's there. We don't have anything similar yet for indigenous people. So I'm just saying, let's be careful. And when we talk about increasing ownership and decision-making powers of indigenous peoples, let's also accompany that discussion with reflection about their accountability. So that's very important. And the other thing, the other point of view on accountability is what I witness is the idea that some states are starting to develop this idea that they can get away, sorry for the trivial wording, get away with some developing process projects that are detrimental to the environment because it's done for the benefit of indigenous peoples, and so to sort of not be accountable for, accounted for. So that's something that you point out in your paper. Benefit sharing should not be seen as a way for states to buy out their right to, for example, do something that's detrimental for the environment. Pepe, how much time do I have still?
We still have 12 minutes, but there is no strict limit, so you can surely make another question.
Okay, excellent. So I will leave it for my last question on the distinction that's been talked about also in other by other speakers between indigenous and local communities. That's something that really it's a recurring theme in your paper, and it's a delicate thing because the two communities, I'm trying to use a neutral word here, are treated differently according to the different sets of norms in human rights and environmental law. So what are your reflections on that?
Yeah, I think early on in the project, and our project 3 years into a 5-year duration, we realized this will probably be one of the hardest questions on our agenda, and we haven't yet come to firm conclusions, although we are keep gathering thoughts. I think one of the tricky aspects of this is that, of course, different bodies of international law deals with this issue to different extents and at different speeds. And I think in international human rights law, this is becoming perhaps much more prominent as of recent. And for different reasons, which may also have changed in time, in some ways this is has been much more present, although not necessarily critically discussed in international biodiversity law. But for how much this can be a very politicized and perhaps even a very legalistic discussion, I think, again, going back to my pragmatic soul, I think there are opportunities there. I mean, for one thing, defining indigenous peoples is not easy in the abstract. There are lots of different obstacles and reasons why governments may or may not recognize indigenous peoples. But also, the reality in the field is so complicated and, again, moving so fast that individuals or groups, there may be, let's say, a gradation of how different groups may be seen as indigenous. The whole indigenous and tribal discussion is there. But I think in some ways, perhaps having local communities there opens up more leeway for different communities to make their claims, and definitely something, and somehow, yes, piggyback perhaps on the successes of the global indigenous movement. But on the other hand, I think that there's also a different rationale that perhaps emerges, not necessarily more clearly, but where we have more international legal materials to reflect upon in international biodiversity law, which is the not necessarily the ethnic or you know, a very nuanced cultural understanding of what local communities may be. And that's really very much to do with even a matter of choice in living a life that is intrinsically connected with nature. And through that, developing a unique form of knowledge about nature, so the holding of traditional knowledge, and therefore the recognition that it may not be an indigenous or a tribal peoples, but there are other communities out there who may have that incredibly tight connection with nature. And you know, in Europe, we may be familiar with mountain communities or island communities. With that and the self-organization of these communities, we may have forms, perhaps, let's say, modern forms of customary law, not necessarily something that goes back in century, but still very unique, idiosyncratic forms of self-regulation that are you know, uniquely connected to nature. And so there, I think the challenge is that we may not have, you know, perhaps ethnic and ethno-cultural groups may not quite capture. And I'm thinking, for instance, crofters communities in Scotland. These are groups. They may include English people who have moved to Scotland for all sorts of different reasons. They may include newcomers and old settled members, community members, who voluntarily join forces, who manage the environment as commons. But that, for at least for the purposes of the Convention on Biological Diversity, have very much to offer and play and the same important role as ecosystem stewards as indigenous peoples. So it's quite interesting to see how this reality will be perhaps understood in human rights terms. This is certainly an ongoing process, and to what extent the contact between international biodiversity law and international human rights law, again, may be seen in a mutually supportive manner. It may well be that this, perhaps the international protections of local communities may be more strongly motivated from an environmental perspective. But it may also raise perhaps an issue of moving away from an individual conception of human rights and really think, well, the protection of those communities may not raise the same concerns in terms of culture, perhaps understood in a certain way, but perhaps has huge implication in terms of our global efforts in protecting human health, life, and other right to food and right to water. Somehow I think it allows us to think in a multi-scalar way vis-a-vis the role of international law and human rights. But it's still very much thinking in progress, as well as international lawmaking in progress. But I mean, perhaps to conclude, just to say that there have been efforts to try and distinguish indigenous peoples from local communities under the Convention on Biological Diversity. This is still a lively discussion, but perhaps to some extent the fact that so far we haven't made progress may torment the academic who likes conceptual clarity, but may have been a helpful element moving forward on the understanding of these complex realities we're dealing with.
Thank you so much. Sorry, just to add a very small thing, drawing from what you were saying and from my personal practical experience in the field again. It's not so much the ontological debate about who are indigenous peoples, who are local communities. I mean, not in addition to that, let's say, that's also important. I think one of the problems is how these communities are reflected upon in the national political system, because there are some norms that are framed based on the fact that indigenous or local communities are different actors from the state. Whereas in practice, at the local level, sometimes indigenous peoples are autonomous. They are considered autonomous, they are practically autonomous, and they have their own political representatives. So they are by all means another actor in front of the state, whereas local communities many times are formally considered something else, but in reality they are represented by the state at the local level. So there's a representative of the state at the centralized level, and there's no dialogue there. So there may be a norm that addresses what you referred as an imbalance of power, while it, in fact it deals only with one actor. That's, from my point of view, the main issue. Mm-hmm. And I would close with that.
Thank you. Thank you. So you put the question and you answered it at the end.
Just so added something
this
to
it. This happens sometime. No, but this is very interesting. And let me see whether there is anyone who wants. Yes, please introduce yourself. Federica, you can start.
Thank you. So it emerged from the discussion that benefit sharing is also a way to basically incorporate other voices into the larger debates on what is international law. And in this perspective, I wanted to know if you could maybe elaborate a bit more on why benefit sharing has an added value in this sense, especially compared to, for instance, participatory rights, because the two concepts are often associated with one another in human rights treaty law, and they're also associated in the CBD, although they're distinguished, they're different moments. So, yes, I just wanted to know in which specific ways benefit sharing adds something to international law in terms of incorporating, for instance, the voice of indigenous peoples or other voices. Thank you.
Maybe we can also collect the other question, and Mark also wants to add something.
Thank you very much. Massimo Zortea from the ICAM department. Thank you, Lisa, for your commitment, personal commitment, in promoting the biodiversity law. Let me provoke you, asking if you think that the ABS origin in the destiny, in the future, is a tool to maintain conflict or to prevent conflict. In other words, I will ask and share with you my sad opinion in order to explain that probably without a well-shared land planning and the policy making with all stakeholders in the natural resources, probably ABS regime, both in the two versions, the ITPGS, the first version of the treaty plans, and now the Nagoya Protocol, is a wall against the attack from external users or resources, instead being a tool in order to share a common vision on how to use, how to maintain the resilience of natural resources. So what about it? Thanks.
Those two questions for now?
Marco, I'm sorry, yeah.
I don't know, perhaps it is too wide, but my curiosity is if you can take position or your views on the debate on uncontacted tribes, which is very interesting. There are two American anthropologists recently proposing and taking the view that contact is inevitable. We should encourage contact in order to protect, because it will happen nonetheless. So the traditional view according to which uncontacted tribes should be absolutely left alone is probably flawed. And the things you said on benefit sharing made me think that perhaps this could have something to do also with this debate. I wanted to hear your views on that.
Thank you. Anyone? Any more? Any more question? No. Okay, so
Freud. So thank you very much for all the questions. I'll do my best. So I think one of the key ongoing questions within the project is exactly that of understanding to what extent benefit sharing contributes and is part and perhaps limited to enhancing participatory rights, or very much about giving voice to certain beneficiaries, or whether it goes beyond. And somehow there's an element of procedural and substance there, although that's always, I think, a very difficult distinction to make. I mean, to some extent, benefit sharing is part and parcel of participatory rights. And one of the points I tried to make in the paper is that perhaps it is a slightly overlooked element in participatory rights. So both with regard to environmental impact assessment and with regard to consultations and processes to obtain free prior informed consent, the idea is always that, well, benefit sharing will come next. First we discuss, we decide whether to say yes or no, and then we'll see what we get out of it. And the argument I'm trying to make is that instead, if we try and see a genuine discussion about fair, what could be fair and equitable sharing of benefits, then the process of environmental impact assessment becomes a much more complex one, one in which, again, we have to open the door to different knowledge systems, to different, not only perhaps our own Western technocratic science-driven approach to understanding impacts, but also understanding what traditional knowledge holders would, how they would pose the terms of the problem. And also fundamentally saying, well, this process is not just about preventing negative impacts. We actually have to broaden the view to understanding what possible benefits may be there, whether there are any in the first place. And similar, I think, for consent and consultations, again, it's the idea that a discussion that completely disregards questions of benefits, any advantages that would be accrued by indigenous peoples and local communities in their own terms, would already be a faulty consultation process, would already be a process where we have a predetermined set of, say, development priorities, which already essentially limits the real opportunities to have voice for indigenous peoples and local communities. But what our research is trying to understand better is also that I think benefit sharing may go beyond that. This, I think, is already quite an important contribution of value added to how we understand participatory rights. But my understanding is that both the use of the verb sharing and the idea, again, of benefits with that hopefully multicultural, multi-knowledge baggage that comes with it really shows that not only you would have voice once a decision has been made, but that voice and your participation and dialogue will then be carried on into any decision and implementation of the decision. And one of the interesting, but again, very problematic manifestations of that will be saying, well, once a certain development project is proposed to indigenous peoples or local communities, it's just not a matter for them to accept it or not, and you know, under which conditions that could be acceptable, but for them to become participants in how the project will be developed, which may be, again, in practical terms, being indigenous peoples being shareholders, indigenous peoples being part of a joint venture. None of this is free from problems. Actually, those arrangements bring their own sets of new problems. But it does show that benefit sharing does not extinguish, let's say, its value added in the participatory process leading to decision making, but is expected to lay the ground for a continued form of partnership that, again, not only is, let's say, the forum where different worldviews, again, continue to be in a dialogue, but also where indigenous peoples have an opportunity to influence the project and be part of whatever changes to the environment may be made, be that a protected area management, as actors, unequal actors in that. And this perhaps leads me to the third question first, if it's okay, and the idea that, to my mind, the realization of fair and equitable benefit sharing is first and foremost a dialogue. And I do agree that then when we think about uncontacted tribes and communities who do not wish to come into contact, then that becomes a difficult scenario that I haven't really thought through yet. But I guess, I mean, what I would agree that the comment, you know, what you mentioned in your comment is that for all different reasons, it may become more and more difficult for those communities to remain uncontacted, and there may be all sorts of pressure that may be derived from national and local pressures and may derive from international pressures. So I think if there is a situation where perhaps there is a risk of that situation of being uncontacted being at stake, I wouldn't see how that could be addressed, particularly if I think there are founded public purpose reasons behind it. There may be questions related to, say, also health or perhaps other reasons which may, where you may have also balancing of perhaps different human rights at stake. But perhaps even understanding the reasons of why certain communities will want to remain uncontacted may require at least a limited, very respectful form of engagement in understanding that position and then for other actors to perhaps react to that and bring that on board. But yeah, certainly thanks for that. I think we'll have to think about it. So whether or not in the particular context of access to genetic resources and benefit sharing, the international rules prevent rather than fuel conflicts. Well, I would agree if I understand well your argument that perhaps in the context of the Nagoya Protocol and the International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources, benefit sharing is almost a defensive mechanism vis-a-vis the protection that comes from intellectual property rights. This is not an aspect I have addressed so much in my paper, but my colleague Elsa Tsumani has written other papers online where she very much engages with that particular dynamic. And I think in some ways there is a potential for conflict in the whole idea of access and benefit sharing. There's quite a lot of expectations that have been created which perhaps are not necessarily very realistic. But once again, in as far as these international rules are understood and applied as mandating genuine dialogue and a dialogue that is geared towards increased mutual understanding and a fair and equitable solution in that no automatic prevalence of, say, the interest of the state where there are necessary or what are seen as necessary limitations to rights, a justification and the existence of a broader benefit that may be accepted and seen as worthy of a certain sacrifice. And to that extent, you mentioned land planning, land use planning. I think that's a key tool where that dialogue should happen, where perhaps the dialogue does not happen, and they can very much set skewed terms of the debate in terms of then the actual discussion among different stakeholders. And we have seen that our case study in Greece, in the island of Ikaria, has very much showed how land use planning is at the core of already almost doomed to failure interaction between different actors on the island, and not just local government and central government and traditional pastoralists, but also other communities or interest groups within the island. So yeah, I hope that addresses to some extent. But perhaps just to conclude, but I think that the truth of the matter is fair and equitable benefit sharing is used with different agendas in mind. The reading I'm trying to propose with my paper is a reading that perhaps gives legal arguments to those that would question more conflictual and perhaps abusive uses of this approach. But it remains a legal argument, and it's very much born from the observation that as a term and the fact that it remains to some extent not fully spelled out in different areas of international law very much is based on the idea that it is convenient to use it for certain, it lends itself to be used for certain perhaps hegemonic agendas.
Good. So I think that we can say that the promises have been kept. Now we know much more than 2.5 hours ago. I must say that I was impressed by this very stimulating mix of traditional topics, traditional issues of international law, such as subjects and sovereignty, and new avenues concerning the benefit sharing, the equitable benefit sharing concept, which has been explored also by Federica in her PhD thesis. I must say that also a lot of concepts of constitutional law have emerged. and I think that Roberto confirm this. The problem of representativeness, for instance, has been touched upon. We did not go in depth, but it's clear that this is one of the most important issues. And also this very interesting distinction or lack of distinction between indigenous peoples and other actors. I would say the distinctive elements of these different actors, which of course means also something in terms of empowerment, another very interesting and not traditional concept in international law. I don't want to add anything. In the original planning, now the idea, before the idea was that of convening all the speakers and the discussants here, but I think that leaving aside the fact that time does not allow us to do it, I think that the discussion was, the overall discussion was extremely interesting. And maybe we have to respect also the fundamental human rights of everybody to have a rest and to think and to reflect upon what we have said. So I thank you very, very much, especially the speakers and the discussants, but also those who intervened, and maybe more than any others, the students who patiently were here in a period in which, as it was said at the very beginning, they are pushed through exams one after the other. So the sacrifice that you made will be surely repaid. So I wish you all the best, and thank you again, everybody.